Dean Cope told me one time, occasionally they get calls to the College of Optical Science from the community about getting a new pair of glasses.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So how did you even know what optical science was?
Well, my father is a software developer. Mm-hmm. So when I came to U of A, I decided to study electrical engineering. And it was more of a passive decision just because my dad's a software engineer. So it makes sense that I could also do software. But then when I was a freshman, I started reading an industrial journal. And I became convinced that optics in electronics was the future of electronics.
How did you get interested in science?
I liked chemistry in high school, which sounds a little weird, but I did. I liked chemistry and math. You know, my mom always had a can-do attitude, you know, yeah. Do whatever you want. So she sold me schools in Philly, Boston, and we had to stop at Syracuse, that's where she went, and D.C. And then I got into Penn Early Decision, so I went to UPenn.
And then once you got to Penn, the whole world is open to you. How did you keep going along this engineering
mentors,
pathway?
Definitely mentors.
Yeah. I had high school students, undergrads, medical students, grad students, postdocs, and it seems like everybody learns from one level above them.
Right.
You know, what's the next thing like? What about the Girls Who Code program? How did that all get started?
The Women in Science and Engineering program here at the University of Arizona has a chapter of which I am program coordinator and lead facilitator. And we use the Girls Who Code nationally provided curriculum to teach computer science to middle school and high school age girls from around Tucson.
Mentorship and what you're doing with the girls at Code, you're already giving back. It's really important for the next wave.
I think sometimes it can be difficult if you're not involved in research to find like graduate students, undergrads find graduate students, or even just mentors in the community would be cool too. Like people who work in engineering.
So that you can see what's it like in the real world. Mm-hmm. How can I apply or translate what I'm learning into a job, into real life activity.
There's a group in College of Optical Sciences called Women in Optics, and they do a lot of demos. They go out to a lot of like local schools, science nights, and do demos. Like, this is what optics is. Look at this cool light experiment. And so I started volunteering with them, and through that club, I met a graduate student who then connected me to her PI, who then hired me to work in his lab.
And it gives you a community, and one of my big things is our retention rate is not where it should be, and I think that's really important to find your community and stay connected, because you want to get up every day and go do the work and be with your friends and be with your network. I think it's really important as we're recruiting new faculty members to the university and retaining the ones that we have.
I think we have to maybe take a different approach to the problem. I've been thinking about this a little bit is with the graduate students that you work or the graduate students in JPL, they're a little bit more diverse. I mean, sometimes we have to grow our own. I know people like are a lot are like, oh, you got to recruit from this school or this school, but we get really top students in some of these areas. There's no reason why as graduate students or undergrads like yourself, we can't, you know, keep in touch with you, make sure when you're done that you apply back here for, you know, in electrical engineering. You know, we can try to get you back after you go to graduate school. But also, you know, we can have someone graduate school mentor them, see if that's what they want to do, send them for a postdoc to get an external experience for a little bit. But I think we have to be a little bit more strategic and growing people, especially now that we're Hispanic serving.
Student success has got to be our mantra.